Doctor Who, The Mark of the Rani, by Pip and Jane Baker, read by Nicola Bryant. Prologue. Evil cannot be tasted, seen, or touched. Yet in Killingworth, a mining community in the northeast of the British Isles, the perception of evil was so overwhelming that even the fabric of the modest terraced dwellings seemed saturated with it. Famine, earthquake, and plague would all sink into insignificance if the contamination afflicting the area were not contained. Like a virus, evil would spread. National barriers, mountain ranges, and oceans would be unable to offer protection. If allowed to flourish, the poisonous epidemic could reduce humankind to a harrowing role that would give a dung beetle superior status. Chapter 1. House of Evil. In a swirl of dust, a small avalanche of coal was being tipped from a truck on an overhead track. Simultaneously, a bell pealed, clangorously signaling the end of a shift. Flexing his shoulders, the begrimed miner manning the tipping operation straightened, easing his aching spine. No sophisticated machinery existed to lighten his burden. No lifts or mechanical loaders. No pithead showers or automated equipment. For this was England at the beginning of the 19th century, prior to the age of the machine. As the miner, Jack Ward, descended from the track, he was joined by others coming off shift. Dirty, dragging weary feet, they made for the tavern to wash the coal dust from their throats before trudging the muddy roads to the tiny stone-built cottages that were their homes. But Jack Ward did not enter the tavern.
"Not coming in, Jack?"
Tim Bass, the creases in his jovial features lined black, blinked with astonishment.
"Nay, lad, don't think I've strength to lift a Toby."
Jack's two mates, Edwin Green and Sam Rudge, fell into step beside him. He gave them a tired grin of greeting.
"I were thinking of trying bathhouse."
Rudge and Green exchanged quizzical looks. They had never been to the bathhouse. It was an innovation, an idea an old woman started in a derelict building not far from the pit.
"Cost, though?"
Sam Rudge was always money conscious. They all were, come to that. Had to be.
"Aye, 12. Even so, just this once."
Fatal words. For as the brawny, round-faced Jack led his two friends up the hill towards the bathhouse, he little knew that he was leading them into a macabre and horrendous trap that would completely change their lives. Little did the Doctor know of the trap he was heading for, either. The TARDIS was performing impeccably. Not an unknown phenomenon. In fact, just what was expected from a time machine. By the Doctor, anyway. So far, no aberrations. He didn't want there to be. His young companion was excited about this trip. Peri had expressed a wish to see Kew Gardens at the beginning of the 19th century, when the horticultural extravaganza was in its infancy. The Doctor, never loath to visit his favourite planet, and curious to see the reactions of this 20th century botanist to the endeavours of her British forebears, was checking the console. He had set the time and space coordinates so that they would arrive beneath the famous lilac trees on a royal open day.
"Must get the coordinates spot on," he mused. "Don't want to land the wrong side of the English Channel. Smack in Napoleon's lap."
A pause for thought. The prospect had some appeal. The Doctor placed an arm across his chest,
tucking the hand under his lapel, a typical Napoleonic stance. Wonder why he always posed like this. Could ask him. He rumpled his unruly mop of fair curls. Be infinitely more interesting than traipsing round a lot of greenhouses. Before he could yield to temptation, Peri came sashaying into the control room, her trim young figure decked in a becoming ankle-length gown. Yellow with red trimmings, it had shoes and parasol to match. Her dark, shiny hair, usually worn short and straight, was fashioned into a bun with bobbing ringlets. She looked good and felt good. Hey, Doctor! This is great! The costume is too large? His mind was still with Napoleon. Large? She was puzzled. The fit was perfect. Isn't that a synonym for great? Anticipating an inevitable lecture on the purity of the language, Peri pirouetted towards him. She wasn't about to get into an argument. Any minute now, given nothing went wrong with the temperamental TARDIS, she'd be in Kew Gardens, mixing with royalty. The Doctor seemed a big hit wherever he appeared, so maybe she'd get an audience with King George III and his Queen. Great! Reflected glory, sure, but some honour for her. Just plain Purple Gilliam Brown of New England, USA. The Doctor was still artlessly absorbed in his theme. Of course, great can also be used for high degree of magnitude. Someone elevated to supremacy, like Napoleon. A judder. A tremendous lurch. Taken by surprise, the Doctor and Peri were thrown off balance. He clung to the console, but she, in the midst of a graceful pirouette, was sent reeling. The old crone running the bathhouse squinted myopically at the approaching miners. She was swathed in a voluminous, coarse grey dress that brushed the cobblestones. A shawl, draped over her straggly tresses, practically concealed her gnarled and wizened features. "Does the wise ones. First year, when water's hot and clean." She extended a mittened hand for payment. "Nay, not wise, Grandma. Just fair wot." Jack gave her a coin, little dreaming that his hard-earned cash was about to buy him the worst experience of his life. A final tremendous shudder, then the TARDIS settled onto an even keel. "What is it? What's happening?" Despite her frequent exposure to the machine's eccentricities, Peri was scared. Already at battle stations, the Doctor scrutinized the stabilizing unit. "Well?" Perry's anxiety made her sound aggressive. "I've never felt better." The Doctor's quip was not what she wanted to hear right now. Cracks like that tell me just one thing." "What?" Concentrating on the display, the Doctor was patently equivocating. "Frankly, that you haven't a clue what's going on." She was wrong. The Doctor did know what was going on. The TARDIS was being manoeuvred off course. At least, not entirely off course. Closer study of the panel showed that the date coordinates remained the same. It was the location that had been changed. "Been changed?" responded Peri when he explained. "Who by?" "Whom?" the Doctor jabbed at the controls, trying to persuade the locator back to the setting for Q. "To use your vernacular, Peri, I haven't a clue." Not absolutely true. He had. They were suffering a navigational distortion from a source situated on Earth.
What could cause a navigational distortion? Don't you know?"
"A very potent force, equal to that of the TARDIS. Another time machine, maybe."
A time machine? Overriding their controls? Pulling them off course?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.